Our goal this morning or afternoon is to look at the book of Exodus. It's a big, huge book, the whole book of Exodus, 40 chapters. We will look at it and just try to learn what God wants to say from this book to us. Now, there is a lot in this book. There's so many wonderful and so many well-known stories are found in the book of Exodus. We have the story of Moses. We have the burning bush. We have the 10 plagues when God is leading his people out of Egypt and he is sending plagues, and it's a marvelous, miraculous thing that happens through these plagues. We have the 10 commandments given on Mount Sinai. We have the tabernacle and how it's a description of it and how it's erected and done. All of this is found in the book of Exodus. So obviously, there's a lot to cover, and we will not have the time, or nor do I want to cover everything that's found in this book. This is going to be just hovering over the book and trying to see some of the messages, or maybe the main message of the book. Think of it this way. If you're maybe invited to a big castle, and there is, in the main hall, there is a giant 30-foot table set with all kinds of delicacies, really good food, and you're just there with your whole family, and it's just filled with really good food. So you're going to just most likely go around and sample things until you're filled, instead of trying to consume it all, because it's impossible. So that's what we're going to do today. We're going to look at this book, and we're going to try to see what does God want us to learn from this book. So to start off with, I wanted to talk about different ways people have tried to make sense of this book. So there has been many or numerous ways to numerous propositions of what this book is about. There, obviously, as I said, there's a lot of things. So some people have said this book is about the descendants of Jacob becoming or transforming from disorganized people into an organized nation. And so the book of Exodus is about descendants of Jacob becoming a nation. Other people have said that the book of Exodus is all about, or the biggest teaching of the book of Exodus is the law. It's giving us ability to understand God's law and how it is should be flushed out in our life, hence the Ten Commandments. Others have said that this book is a story of Moses, the life of Moses, and how God used him in the life of the nation. And all of these things are true. All of these things are correct in people describing the theme of the book of Exodus. But what I will suggest today is that the book of Exodus is really a book about us. And not in a man-centered type of way, but in a way that this book describes people and describes a struggle of people that we can so closely relate to today. This book is really showing us that regardless of how good and powerful we know God to be, our hearts will still lead us to mistrust God and to look for other sources of safety and stability in life. So this book is really showing us that regardless of how good and powerful we know God to be, our heart will still continue to lead us to mistrust God and to look for other sources of stability and safety in our life. And so I think ultimately the biggest message of this book is about a merciful God who continues to pursue his people, continues to be merciful even amidst rebellion, judgment. He continues to be merciful and kind and continues to lead his people until the accomplishment of his great manifestation of grace and mercy. So this is the main message of Exodus that we're going to look at. Just a couple more words about the book of Exodus. It's important to mention that it's probably not even accurate to say the book of Exodus or one of the five books of the Torah, because these first five books, known as the Torah, were always considered as a book of Moses. Whenever we see references in the New Testament, even Jesus referring to the book of Moses, he's not referring to one of the books, he's referring to the five scrolls. So the way these books, the reason they're separated was most likely because of the scroll length. They had to separate them, but this was really one united, or book that was that contained one big story. And so when we look at the book of Exodus, we have to realize that we should never look at it in isolation from other books like Genesis and the rest of the books like Deuteronomy or Leviticus. And so we will look at this book in the context of all the five books, or the big book of Moses. And it's especially important for us to look at this book in a way that we should never look at this book in a way that makes it seem like Jesus has never come. Because the book of Moses is so, or the book of Exodus is so much longing, or so much foreshadowing of the great sacrifice, of the great tabernacle, or God coming to dwell with his people. And we will mention that as we look at this book as well. So if you want to find your Bibles and open to the book of Exodus, we're going to just start from the beginning, and we're going to look through different passages and try to see that message that I've mentioned earlier in this book. So I'm going to divide it this book into three portions, or three thematic progressions. So the first point of this book, or the first progression, is the first point is marvelous liberation. Marvelous liberation. So, and that's found from the beginning of the book and until we are at the Mount Sinai. So marvelous liberation. So the book starts with description of the people of Israel, sons of Jacob, are in Egypt, and they're having a really hard time. The king of Egypt, Pharaoh, is threatened by these people. He feels threatened, so he is coming up with a way to subdue these people, and he is making them into slaves. Treating them ruthlessly, as it says in chapter 1, verse 14. In all their work, they ruthlessly made them work as slaves. So the people of Israel find themselves in a very difficult and hard circumstance. They are being mistreated. They are treated in a way that makes their life very hard. And so we see how God is acting to pursue his people, to save them out of this difficulty, out of this slavery, and to fulfill his promises to Abraham of the land that he has promised long ago. And so we meet Moses here. Chapter 2 starts with the story of Moses. God is saving his life, and Moses, who is saved out of water, grows up in the presence of Pharaoh. He is growing and learning the ways of Egypt, and he is realizing that his people are being mistreated. And so we find Moses coming out and seeing his people being mistreated, and he is murdering a person and hiding the evidence, and then running into the desert. So we're not going to talk about all the details of Moses, but some of the things that I just wanted to mention about Moses is that Moses was not a perfect person. He was not a person that you would think that really qualifies to be this great leader. he becomes one because God chooses and draws him and calls him out of the desert where he lives and is being a shepherd there. But we see that Moses is, first of all, that instance with murderer of the Egyptian who is mistreating his people. Then we see him when he is speaking with God in the desert. He sees the burning bush. God calls him to lead his people. Moses is being very reluctant to follow God. He's saying, I am not a person who can even speak. I have issues with speaking, and so please don't send me to do what you're asking me to do. He's being very reluctant. So I hear this often. I overhear conversations of people who are using dating websites to find a spouse, and so apparently there is a big questionnaire that you have to complete in order to make sure that you will be qualified. The person who's looking for a spouse or for a person to date, they will use that questionnaire in order to see if the person that they want to date qualifies what they want them to look like. And so if we look at Moses and if we think of the questionnaire that he would have to fill out for God's qualification to be a leader of his people, we see that Moses definitely does not fit the requirements that we would think he should have. And yet we see that God takes that which may be considered as someone who is not qualified, someone who may be considered as not the person who could do great things, and we see God taking him and empowering him and using him to do marvelous things for his glory. And so as we talk about this marvelous liberation, the first part of this book, we have to realize that it is all God's sovereign grace and sovereign kindness that is displayed as the nation of Israel leaves Egypt and is liberated from captivity and from slavery there. So we see in chapter 3, the burning bush, God coming to Moses and revealing himself to him as I am. So I'm going to read to you from verse 13 in chapter 3. God describes he as he is leading the nation of Israel. God wants them to know who he is, that it is not just some power, some deity amongst others, but it is Yahweh, the God of Abraham and Jacob. Then Moses said to God, if I come to the people of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. So God is revealing his identity. He's connecting himself to that same God. He says that I am that same God who is the God of Isaac and Jacob. The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations. So we will go ahead and skip down to chapter 6, or chapter 8 actually. There's the description of the second plague, the frogs. We'll actually not talk about all of the plagues here. I just wanted to mention a couple things here, that God is really displaying his power as someone who is over and above all the gods of Egypt and someone who has the power to liberate, to subdue, and to accomplish his will amongst resistance of Pharaoh and his his people. So we'll skip through the very well-known stories here. We have the story of the 10 plagues, and we're going to come back to the story, the last plague, where the firstborn are dying. We'll come back to that story. But I wanted to go ahead and skip to the description of the covenant where they come to Sinai, to the Ten Commandments, and God is revealing himself in the Ten Commandments. So in chapter 19, here's the description of what is happening by the Sinai. It says in chapter 19, "On the third new moon, after the people of Israel had gone out from the land of Egypt, on that day they came into the wilderness of Sinai. They set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain, while Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, 'Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all the peoples. For all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel.'" So God is coming to the people of Israel and says, "I want to make a covenant with you. I am giving you my laws. I'm giving you my commandments. And I want you to be my special people." And then the people do promise, and they say, "All that God has said, we will do." And so in chapter 20, God gives the Ten Commandments, or the law, to them. And we see the description of the Ten Commandments, chapter 20, the beginning of it until verses 17. And then afterwards, it follows with a description of many laws, or numerous laws that God gives, laws that we often read and we scratch our head and we say, how does this apply to us? In fact, I remember speaking with a person who said, after he actually listened to this book, and he said, the biggest thing that I realized after listening to the laws that God gives here is that I'm so glad we don't have to do them anymore in the New Testament. I'm so glad that it doesn't apply to us. And so there is a certain confusion of why do we even need to read these laws, or how do these laws apply to us? And what's often missed is that the description of the laws about slaves, the laws about a virgin, or and how if she's mistreated, this should be the punishment for that. All of these different specific things that seem to apply only to that nation and only for their time, they actually teach us about God, his goodness, and his desire to protect the weak and the vulnerable. So as we read through these laws, we see the heart of God in them. And yes, maybe we don't necessarily have to obey everything in them, because they may not apply to our situation, our current justice system. But what these laws are meant to teach us is that God cares for the weak and the vulnerable. And so as Moses receives this, the laws in verse 24, he also brings Nadab and Abihu and the elders for them to experience God in chapter 24. And God proceeds to the description of in chapters 26, God proceeds to give a description of the tabernacle. Again, the people have confirmed that they want to do what God has said. They said, everything that God has commanded, we will do. And so in chapter 26, beginning of chapter 26 and 27, we see a description of the tabernacle. And again, very many numerous details of all these items that are to be present in the tabernacle, the way it should be constructed, the altar in chapter 27, the court, the oil of lampstand. And so we often, again, we get very much confused of why all this detail and how is it applicable to us? Why do we need to read through these things? And so just a couple words, again, as we look at this book of Exodus and try to understand its message and how it applies to us, we need to see that the tabernacle is actually a great display of God's mercy to the nation of Israel. It is God's way of saying, I want to be close to you and I want to dwell with you. This idea of tabernacle or a dwelling place, a tent that's erected in the midst of the nation of Israel is there so that the people of Israel can know and sense that God is with them. He is near. The nearness of God and the closeness of God was lost in the Garden of Eden when Adam and Eve have sinned against God, and now God is making a way for him to draw close again to his people. And so as we read the description of the tabernacle in different details of it, we need to understand it in the sense like a bride who is preparing for a wedding. A bride and a groom, it's most often the bride that is so much concerned with the details of how the wedding will be, how the decoration will be on the stage, her dress, all the different details of it, the sitting arrangement, the music. And so in the same way, we see that this special occasion of God coming down to dwell with people and them drawing close to him is described in these details. And the reason why they're there is to show how special and amazing of a event that is, that God is dwelling with his people. And so let's just go through some of the items that are found in the tabernacle that God is instructing Moses and the people of Israel to do and to make. We have here the Ark of the Covenant and the Mercy Seat. In chapter 25, verse 10, gives a description of the Ark and the Mercy Seat. We have Table of Bread in same chapter, verse 23. We have the Table of Bread, where this table has fresh bread set out there regularly. Now, again, think of the symbolism that is portrayed here in the description of the tabernacle. This symbolism points to one fact, that God is there, present. Think of a regular tent where a person dwells. There will be food, bread, there will be light, the lampstands. And so all of these elements that are found in this description are pointing to the fact that someone is there, that someone is actively living there. And so these details, like the bread that's freshly set out there, and the lampstands, and the tent itself, all of these things are pointing to the fact, they symbolize that God is there, present, that someone is indwelling this habitation, that this tent is occupied by someone who lives there, And all of this symbolism comes together to portray that this someone is great and marvelous and merciful. You have the light burning there throughout the night, signifying that even at night, God is with his people. You have even the garments and the way they're supposed to be made, the garments of priests are giving specific details. And again, why is that happening? If you look at chapter 28, verse 2, in the description of them, it says, "And you shall make holy garments for Aaron your brother for glory and for beauty." Everything about the tabernacle, everything about the place where God dwells speaks of glory and beauty and mercy. All of these things were in commandments in the way it was supposed to be made, were pointing to that. And so we see the description of the tabernacle, all of these things that God is giving. So God is giving the law to, and then the description of the tabernacle. So we see in all of this that first point of marvelous liberation. It's not just that God has led the nation of Israel out of captivity, out of slavery. God is also drawing close to them. He is revealing himself to the nation. He is giving his laws to protect and bless his people. He is erecting a place of dwelling for himself in their midst so that he could be close to them. And all of that is marvelous liberation. All of that is God's gracious and merciful gift to them. And with all of that, we come to chapter 32. And that is the description of what happens as Moses is receiving all of these details from God on Mount Sinai. Chapter 32, it says, when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered themselves together to Aaron and said to him, "Up, make us gods who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." And we'll read down through verse 10. "So Aaron said to them, 'Take off the rings of gold that are in the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to come to me.' So all the people took off the rings of gold that were in their ears and brought them to Aaron, and he received the gold from their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool and made a golden calf. And they said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.' When Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made a proclamation and said, 'Tomorrow shall be a feast to the Lord.' And they rose up early the next day and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings, and the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play." What a contrast. What a contrast of what God is doing and the mercy he's showing to the nation and to what is happening with the nation of Israel. And that is, again, that is a description, or it's showing us that even though the people saw God's marvelous display of glory throughout the 10 plagues, as they witnessed God's power and glory and majesty, even with all of that, their heart led them to doubt God, to doubt his goodness, and their heart stirred them away from God to seek other sources of safety and stability. Now, I title this section as "Even Greater Danger." So the first point was marvelous liberation into greater danger. As God is delivering his people out of slavery, the people of Israel find themselves in much greater danger than they were in Egypt. And here is the description here in verse 7. And the Lord said to Moses, "Go down, for your people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way that I commanded them. They have made for themselves a golden calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" And then listen to this. "And the Lord said to Moses, 'I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Now, therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, in order that I may make a great nation out of you.'" So the nation, the people of Israel, even though they were liberated from slavery, are now in danger, in much greater danger, as they face the wrath of God for their rebellion and disobedience and doubting of God. Now, this was coming because we, even before this incident with the calf, we saw how as soon as the nation of Israel has left Egypt, they have went through the Red Sea. God has marvelously displayed his power and mercy as they crossed through the Red Sea and were saved from the army of the Egyptian army. The next thing that happens, they sing a song of praise to God, the song of Moses in chapter 15. And in verse 22, we see that they come upon water that is bitter, and people begin to grumble. They grumble against Moses and they grumble against God. Same thing happens in chapter 16, where they are going through the wilderness and they become hungry. In chapter 16, it says, and they start to grumble against Moses and against Aaron and against God. So we see that this grumbling or this rejection of God and this doubting of God was coming. This was something that already appeared, and this was just a big display of how people are rejecting God and they are choosing to disobey him. Notice here that when God is speaking to Moses, he says, "Your people." Instead of saying "my people," he now says "your people" in chapter 32. Signifying that these people are not really belonging to him, in that sense that their hearts are still not after God. Their hearts are not set to follow him. They are seeking their own sources of safety and stability. That description also of people rising up to play as they erect the golden calf, as they worship him, is a description of this lewd behavior, of this crude and offensive sexual behavior that is characteristic of worship of so many nations of that time, and including the nation of Egypt. There was something that was happening, and people were imitating that. So it's a great offense against everything that God has just given them in the Ten Commandments, and what people have promised to do as God told them that God wants to make a covenant with them. And so people are choosing to, instead of following God, they're choosing to worship this calf. And now the calf was a symbol of a God that they could see and that they could directly influence. It was something that they could do to control, whereas the God of Sinai, the God that appeared, was a God who was much more mysterious, who was much less influenced by their actions, a God who spoke and a God who they were to follow and obey. This calf that they have made is someone that they could sacrifice to, is someone that they could see, is someone that they could transport with them and to influence to a much greater degree than they could Yahweh, the God that appeared to them. And so we see that God's anger is is about to be on display. He's speaking to Moses, and he says, "Leave me alone, that my anger may burn, and that I may destroy these people." This is a great danger that people are in. They find themselves in as they are rebelling against God. So liberation, marvelous liberation, and even greater danger here. And so as God is saying to Moses, "Leave me alone, that my anger can burn," it is almost as if God is inviting Moses to plead and to intercede for the nation. In verse 11 of chapter 32, we see that that's exactly what happens. Moses starts pleading for the nation. In verse 11 says, "But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, 'O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with your mighty hand?'" And so Moses is pleading with God for mercy and pleading with him, giving him reasons like, these are your people. You have promised to deliver your people. You have brought them out of Egypt. And in verse 12, "Why should the Egyptians say, 'With evil intent did he bring them out?'" He's pleading with God on the basis of his glory, that his mercy would bring him greater glory as if he displays his mercy at this time and doesn't destroy these people. And so we see that God relents from his desire, from his intention to destroy the people. And in verse 14 it says, "And the Lord relented from the disaster that he had spoken of bringing of his people." So that's the other part that I want to talk about, the third point, and that is even greater mercy. So marvelous liberation from Egypt. Again, we're trying to look at this whole book and the message of this book and try to tie it together. The first is marvelous liberation. The nation of Israel is coming out of Egypt. They are given the law to protect and bless them. They are given God's blessing of his presence. We see their rebellion because their heart doubts God. We see them in great danger, about to be destroyed by the anger of God. And now we come to even greater mercy. We see that God, instead of destroying the people, he is showing them mercy. We see that as the events unfold, yes, Moses comes down, he destroys the tablets of Ten Commandments. He shows people how terrible of a thing they have done. In fact, people are not ready to repent. They still continue to resist. They still continue to in their practice. In fact, it takes Moses to send a group of people to start destroying people who are continuing in their rebellion, for them to be stopped in what they're doing in the worship of the golden calf. And yet, through all of this, God is showing his mercy by keeping his people. In fact, it's interesting to note here that God chooses to be merciful to these people before they do anything to repent over their sin. In chapter 32, verse 14, God is showing mercy. He's relenting from the disaster he was about to bring, even before, as they are continuing to worship the calf. In that very moment, God says, "I will not destroy them. I will listen to what you're saying, how you're imploring me, Moses, and I will show my mercy, even in the moment of rebellion." And in that, we see God's great mercy. We see God's marvelous liberation. We see this great danger, and we see his even greater mercy as God is being merciful to these people, even amidst their rebellion. And that is what I think this book is really trying to show us the greatness of God in his liberation of his nation, and the danger of his holiness that we find ourselves in even greater mercy. And when you go to the very end of the book, as the nation repents, as Moses goes again to the Mount of Sinai and he writes the Ten Commandments again, we see that God's presence actually does descend. As the tabernacle is erected and built and all of the things that God has commanded to do and place in the tabernacle, all of those things are made. We see in chapter 40, we see God's glory actually descending on the tabernacle and his presence actually closely coming and being with his nation. In chapter 40, verse 34, it says, "Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud settled on it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle." This is how the book of Exodus ends. The glory of the Lord is actually coming down and dwelling. His presence is filling the tabernacle. Again, what a contrast. What a contrast to what happened very, very recently. The nation of Israel rebelling against God and worshiping a golden calf and rejecting God, rejecting and turning back away from all the marvelous things he has done. And yet at the end of the book of Exodus, we find that God actually descends and mercifully dwells with the people. All of that was made possible because of this imploring of Moses, this intercessory work that Moses is doing, which I think is such an amazing picture of the work of Christ, who implored and who pleaded and who suffered on our behalf. Of course, Moses even goes to the extent of saying in chapter 32, alas, in verse 31, "Alas, this people have sinned a great sin. They have made for themselves gods of gold. But now if you will forgive their sin, but if not, please blot me out of the book that you have written." So Moses is saying, you can blot me out of the book that you have written, which God doesn't do that. God doesn't destroy Moses for the sins of people. And yet we know that Christ was destroyed for the sins of his people. Jesus Christ did lay his life down so that we could be close with God. So as we wrap up this book, I want to again come back to that theme that I said in the very beginning, that regardless of how much we have seen and experienced God's goodness and power, our heart will continue to lead us to mistrust God and to find other sources of safety and stability, which brings us into a great danger. And we know that the story of Exodus, or the story of the nation of Israel, doesn't end here. All of the people there actually do get destroyed by the anger of God. They all perish and they die, and their bodies remained in the wilderness. They never entered the promised land. In Numbers 14, I want to read to you from Numbers 14, verse 2. This is a passage describing the time when these people have actually came to the border of Canaan, and they looked at the people there, and they said, "These people are too powerful. If it's a trap, God, you have brought us here." They're speaking to Moses, and of course implying God, that you have brought us here to destroy us. It would have been better if we died in the wilderness. And so in chapter 14 of Numbers, chapter 14, It says, and all the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The whole congregation said to them, "What would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become a prey." And so they are speaking and saying, this is a trap. Why are we here? The Lord wants to destroy it. So these people, even though they have seen the marvelous display of God's liberating power as they left Egypt, even though they have experienced and they knew that God was about to destroy them in their rebellion, and they saw his mercy, great mercy, and God's presence in dwelling or being there amidst them in the tabernacle. With all of that, their hearts continued to lead them away from God. And we see in chapter 14 of Numbers, verse 28, it says, God is speaking and says, "Say to them, as I live, declares the Lord, what you have said in my hearing, I will do to you. Your dead bodies shall fall in this wilderness. And of all your number, listed in the census from 20 years old and upward, who have grumbled against me, not one shall come into the land where I swore that I would make you dwell, except Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun." So we see very clearly that even though God's mercy is displayed and his presence is near, that has not taken care of the greatest problem, and that's the problem of their hearts that keeps leading them away from God. The problem of that rottenness in the heart, it's like a cavity that was filled, but it was not cleaned before it was filled. Or a car that was in the flood, and you are considering to buy this car, and it looks really good and shiny, and it even starts, and the price is right. But you can never rely on that car because of all the damage that's inside of this car. And so in the same way, even though there were all these great, great displays and blessings and even the nearness of God, you have this rottenness of heart inside their heart, this heart that seeks them to continually doubt God and continually reject him and rebel against him and bring even greater danger and greater judgment until they all perish in the wilderness. And so as God is speaking of the new covenant, that he will give to the nation, he's speaking of that which will take care of this great problem of their hearts. He's speaking that this new covenant that he will make with his people will be a covenant that changes their heart. And so, in the book of Ezekiel, God is speaking of that very covenant that will change and turn their hearts to him. In chapter 11 of the book of Ezekiel, God says the following words. Chapter 11, verse 19. He says, "And I will give them one heart, and a new spirit I will put within them. I will remove the heart of stone from their flesh, and give them a heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes and keep my rules and obey them. And they shall be my people, and I will be their God." Also in Ezekiel chapter 36, similar words are found here in chapter 36 of Ezekiel, verse 26. God says, "And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. So we, as those who are people of the new covenant, we have this great mercy of God that is not just displaying his greatness, that is not just liberating us, that is not just forgiving our sins. This covenant or this relationship with God that we can have in Christ also changes our hearts. It changes the bent of our heart. It changes this consistent desire to doubt God and to turn away from him to find other sources of safety and stability. I was talking to a soldier once that was serving in South Korea, and he was speaking how there at the border of North and South Korea there is these loudspeakers installed that blasts this propaganda or this message of how great North Korea is and how great the ruler of North Korea is. And so it's interesting that what I'm trying to illustrate is that as as we live within the new covenant, as we live as those who have new hearts, we definitely will hear the messages of the world to disobey God and to turn against him and to doubt him. In fact, we have traitors in our own heart. And it's interesting when I was listening to the story of the soldier, that the people in North Korea may actually believe the messages that they may overhear through these loudspeakers. But the people of South Korea, or the people who have tasted freedom, or those who know what it is to live under a different type of government, they know that this message will never persuade them fully. This message will not really persuade them to run for North Korea and to become citizens of that country. And so with us. When God gives us a new heart, when God liberates us, when God gives us a heart of flesh that wants to obey him, we still hear the messages. Even in our own heart, the traitors of our own heart, we still hear the messages to doubt him. But as God in his mercy will continue to hold us, as he's giving us a new heart, he gives us this ability to be with him. He is holding us, holding us close to him. And what is holding us is actually the realization of his mercy, the realization that we can be satisfied in him. So as I finish, I want to read from Psalm 90. I was reading through this psalm this last week, and this psalm is actually written during the time of Israel's journey through the wilderness. As they were experiencing the wrath and anger of God, they were experiencing their own desire to run from God and to disobey God. Moses is writing this psalm. Psalm 90 starts with these words, a prayer of Moses, the man of God. And Moses is describing in a very interesting way of how his heart wants to seek to belong to the Lord and not sway from him. And so in verse 13, he says the following words, verse 13 and 14, Moses says, return, O Lord, how long? Have pity on your servants. And in verse 14, he says, satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. It is that satisfaction with God's steadfast love that we experience, the renewal of the satisfaction of with steadfast love of God that allows us to continue serving God, continuing to be with him, to continue to rejoice, as it says here, and to be glad all our days. So as we finish this book, the message that we see here is a message of God's marvelous liberation of his people that brings them into even a greater danger as they encounter his holiness and they encounter their own hearts, the danger of their own hearts to doubt God and to seek other sources. We see greater mercy to the nation of Israel. And as we have said that we could never treat this book in isolation, we see even much greater mercy as God shows us and the people of the new covenant as he gives them a new heart and he draws them to himself and he actually dwells in their heart, no longer just in the tabernacle amidst the people, but in the heart of his people. I wanted to pray right now, if you would bow your heads with me, and I want to praise God for his mercy to us that he is displaying through this book. Father, we thank you that you give us another reminder of your greatness, a power to liberate. And you give us another reminder of the deceitfulness of our hearts as we seek other sources apart from you to be satisfied, to find safety and comfort. And Lord, as we realize the danger of this, the danger of our hearts to lead us away from you, we are grateful that you give us the mercy of changing our hearts and to drawing us to yourself and to indwelling our hearts with your Spirit so that we can belong to you. And as we hear the traitors in our own hearts to persuade us to doubt you, we can be safe in your arms, knowing your mercy as we daily experience your grace. And we praise you for that through Jesus, who made this all possible. And it is in his name we pray. Amen.